the same as him. Blueberry bagel, ultra cream cheese, decaf, please. How's it going, Cal?
Fine. Do we know each other?
I know everybody. I'm God.
Makes you happy, I'll believe you.
How's your sister June doing?
You know her?
Know her? I practically helped you find her a couple of years ago.
Who are you?
How about a little thunder?
This gotta be one of those reality TV shows. Where's the camera at? Is it?
There are no cameras, Cal.
You really are God. Now, I've heard that God does speak to people.
Not exactly.
No, there's this minister that claims God speaks to him. Pat something.
Pat Robertson? I've never uttered a word to that schmuck.
Schmuck? Are you Jewish?
I'm like tofu. Tofu. You add your own flavor? People see me in their own image. In China, I'm short, chubby, inscrutable. In Africa, I'm tall, muscular, voice like James Earl Jones. In Minnesota, I'm a blonde, blue-eyed gore.
Wait, this gotta be a prank. Did Marvin put you up to this?
Marvin Schwartz, 223 West 10th Street, in the Village, third floor.
Yeah, Marvin.
You like to tango, right? Enjoy. Don't worry. Nobody else heard that.
What do you want?
Nothing. I'm just looking in on you.
Looking in?
You missed the Shabbos service last Friday on WQXR radio at Temple Emmanuel.
I was busy.
It's okay. I was just wondering, since you've been listening to it for so many years.
I can't miss one service?
Sure, it's okay. I was just thinking maybe you were losing your faith a little.
Who said I had faith?
For the past 11 years, every Friday at 5:30, and you tell me...
It's a habit.
A habit? Is it also a habit when you're driving around Manhattan searching for parking spaces? I see you. You rub that steering wheel. Rub, rub, rub. A space opens up. You pull in. And I hear you. You say, thanks, God.
You can hear me.
Why the heck do you think you get all those parking spaces?
This is amazing.
Of course, in the immediate area of the theater district, free parking is impossible. Even I can't help there.
I noticed.
Yes.
I was just saying, God. I'd always hoped that you existed, but I was never sure. But there is a God. My God.
People believe in God in the most remote parts of the world. Bali, Mozambique, Tierra del Fuego, even Hoboken. Just kidding.
What are you doing?
Googling you.
Googling me. God uses Google.
I just said that I have my own private account.
There's stuff on there about me?
Plenty.
Wait, why are you using Google? Aren't you supposed to know everything right up in here?
After so many billions of years, my noodle's not as sharp as it used to be. I think I'm getting a touch of the,
Alzheimer's?
Yeah. Ah, here are your Bergen Street Elementary grades. Almost all A's. Your great-grandma Ida was so proud of you.
I love to make her happy. I would always run home with my report card to show her. She never said an unkind word. I could get a B every once in a while, and she would just look at me over her glasses and smile and say, B is good, but A is better.
And here's the time you refused to be bar mitzvahed.
That wasn't for religious reasons. I had taken all the lessons in the neighborhood shul, but right before the big day, I panicked. Scared to get up in front of those old farts and with beards and recite stuff in Hebrew.
Your great-grandma Ida was very disappointed. And then, in the army, when you joined the army, why did you become a Catholic?
What's wrong with being Catholic? Do you just favor the Jews?
No. All religions are fine. I was just curious. Why?
You're saying you don't know why people do things.
I see what people do. I don't always understand what's going on in their heads. Come on, get it out. It'll make you feel better.
Well, at Fort Benning down in Georgia, there was this young Catholic chaplain, and I fell in love with the guy. No, not like that. No. I mean, I actually loved the guy. He was so holy and pure and innocent and so bright. I was just 19, and I had never felt inspired by religion before. The way he was, I wanted to be a part of that. So I told him I wanted to become a Catholic. But you saw that.
I'd sort of forgotten the details, but go on.
He told me this was a very, very serious decision, but I kept bugging him. I'm a Taurus, stubborn. Eventually he gave me catechism lessons. Not long after that, he baptized me, got me a silver crucifix with rosary beads, and I went to confession, and he would listen to me. It was wonderful.
And then?
Probably know the rest.
Oh, come on, I like hearing you tell it.
After I got out of the army, there, I went to a Catholic church in Elizabeth, New Jersey. Grumpy old priest. He would murmur all the prayers, and during the Sunday sermon, what I remember most was him kvetching about how little people were donating to the church, so I stopped going.
And the crucifix?
I took it off, but I couldn't throw it away. I couldn't. I kept it in my pocket for a couple of years, and it must have been the friction in my pants. Rubbing away from it. If the rosary beads fell off, eventually it was just a silver crucifix with 3 or 4 beads on each side.
That's when your great grandma became ill, wasn't it?
She was 92. Slipped and fell in the kitchen. That Labor Day weekend, some of my buddies said that they were going down to the Jersey Shore. I said I'd see him later. I went to go visit my grandma in the nursing home. She was fading, but sweet as ever. I kissed her on the forehead and walked out. Driving south down the highway, it was misty. And I got to Bradley Beach and parked. It was dark out on the boardwalk. It must have been nearly midnight. I didn't know where any of my buddies were. Walked out onto the beach, laid a big towel across the sand. I laid down and fell asleep.
Early the next morning, the sun woke me. I noticed my wallet and keys had fallen out of my pocket. I reached around and found them, then I noticed my crucifix was missing. I reached to the sand again, searching, and then I found something. It wasn't my crucifix. I picked it up, and it was a round, shiny piece of metal. It was
Star of David, then.
I was amazed. I stared at it, then I looked up to the heavens. I was all alone, and this light was shining down on me through the clouds. And it was as though something incredible had happened. I kept poking around in the sand to find my crucifix, but it was gone.
I left it there for a good Christian. He found it a couple months later.
You did that? Why?
You figure it out.
I can't, it's a mystery.
Ah, sweet mystery of life, at last I've found thee. I know at last the secret of it all.
It's about love.
Peter Johnson Young wrote those words. Wasn't it divine when Nelson Eddy and Jeanette McDonald sang it?
Come on, tell me.
You loved your great-grandma, didn't you?
I adored her. She was dying. I had let her down on it and get bar mitzvahed. When I found that Star of David, I was turning to who I was to please her. That's it.
If that's what you think, that's what it is.
Man, why are you so mysterious?
Ah, sweet mystery of life, at last I've found thee.
God?
Yes?
Why do you let such terrible things happen?
You know what really bugs me? When terrible things happen, huge disasters, earthquakes, floods, hurricanes, tsunamis, and so many people die. People call them acts of God. Can you believe that? Acts of God. As if I wanted them to happen.
I thought you were all powerful.
There are over 6 billion people on Earth. If I devoted just one second to each person, it would take me 206 years to get around to everyone. People are constantly calling out to me. In the deserts of Sudan, dying of thirst or hunger. Africa, India, Greenwich Village, young men and women dying of AIDS. In Iraq, young soldiers writhing in pain. In the casinos of Atlantic City, desperate gamblers losing their shirts. They all want something. Help me, God. I try. I mean, I'm pretty good at multitasking, but sometimes it's overwhelming.
It must keep you very busy.
It was all so simple when I created the universe. The Earth rotating around the sun at exactly 67,000 miles per hour. I cooked up just the right temperature. Just the right mixes of gases allowing for life. And then the plants and the animal. Then when I decided to create humans, I got this ricotta idea. Start them off ignorant. Tabula rasa. But give them creativity and free will.
Why are you telling me this?
I'm trying to help you understand. Humans in the beginning were like animals. Bare asses in the wind. Hunters and gatherers. Millions died of hunger and disease. But with creativity and free will, clothing, farming, medicine, electricity, radio, TV, the movies, the internet. Now, blogging. Oh, it might not seem like it, but life's changing. Mostly for the better.
Why do you allow for somebody to know that there's been so much injustice in the world?
Talk about injustice. They erect great statues to great warriors, but do they ever erect a statue to the man who invented Imodium?
Imodium?
Just a century ago, do you know how many people died of diarrhea? Or even pooped their pants? I can't tell you how many times nowadays people cry out, "Thank God for Imodium." It wasn't me. It was some scientist who had free will.
There's been so much evil in the world, like African slavery, the Holocaust, and monsters like Hitler.
When Hitler was a young boy, his mother was dying of cancer in terrible pain. I sent a Jewish doctor to his house, made over 40 visits, never charged a penny. Hitler said he was grateful, but free will, a mass murderer, and a vegetarian. I still don't understand the guy.
Did you actually talk to Hitler?
He was a closed-minded man. And besides, I don't really talk to people. I just kind of whisper in their ear. You like Mozart, right?
Mozart makes you cry?
For joy. The human voice raised in song is so glorious. And Walt Whitman. Have you ever read his The Sleepers?
Yeah, but I don't recall what that has to do with
it. I wander all night in my vision, stepping with light feet, swiftly and noiselessly stepping and stopping, bending with open eyes over the shut eyes of the sleeper. Whitman is speaking in my voice, to me, to everyone.
God.
Yes?
Why did my mom have to die?
I'm sorry about that.
She was 22. I just turned to, except for a photo, I have a memory of her.
I know.
My Uncle Eddie and his wife Elizabeth were living in North Carolina a couple of years ago. They sent me letters my mom had written to them years ago. Those letters are my greatest treasures. My mom and dad had separated and she was living with her grandparents at the time. In Newark. Eddie and Elizabeth had just had their firstborn child, Barbara.
Hello, Pappy. How glorious that Elizabeth has come through fine with a precious bit of heaven. Give him a kiss from all of us, and a wet one from Calvin. Grandma wishes she were able to make it a trip down south, but it seems that there's a nasty villain called Money that always eludes us. Calvin walks by himself. He's so proud of himself. He keeps on saying, "Alone, alone, alone," declaring that he doesn't need our help anymore. Soon, you'll be boasting of your daughter's accomplishments. Isn't it a wonderful feeling to have a child? A tiny little body to love and cherish. It is truly something to live for, to cry for, to lie, to laugh in, and die for.
A few months later, my mom wrote again to North Carolina.
Dear Mommy, Daddy, and Barbara, please, please forgive me for being so late answering. I'm at last working as a sales girl in a dress shop. When I get home, I'm so tired, all I can do is kiss Calvin goodnight and go to bed. How's my darling new cousin? I feel like an aunt to her. What does she look like? Does she eat like a piggy so that she'll get fat and adorable? Aren't they gorgeous, precious things to have? They're expensive and troublesome, but one tiny smile and all is forgiven. When I get home from work, I feel so utterly alone and morbid after waiting on nasty, picky women all day. But Calvin runs up to me, throws his arms about me, and says, "Mommy, kiss." Well, it's my seventh heaven.
The third and last letter from North Carolina was written shortly after my second birthday. My mom... say this. She was very pregnant with my sister.
May 19th. My dear aunt, uncle, and Barbara. Your lovely box of candy was received with avid exclamations of oohs and ahs. Grandma thanks you from the bottom of her heart. Calvin refused all candy but that which came from Grandma. He said, "It is beautiful." He draws his words out and uses much expression. Soon, I'll send pictures of my son. He's the roughest, toughest kid on the street. He plays ball with all the big boys and shouts, "Make a double." He plays marbles like a veteran and sings all the latest songs, all at the age of 2. All hear a well. Love from all to all. Rosalind.
Well, 12 days later, she gave birth to my sister. She lay bleeding in the city hospital. One theater in downtown Newark, the lights were turned on, and they made pleas for blood donors. She died a few hours later.
I know.
Of course you know. Why did she have to die?
Doctors today know how to avoid a hemorrhage in a pregnant woman. Not then. And your father with his depression, poor guy. A little Zoloft or Prozac might have helped.
When I first met my dad, he was in his late 60s. I flew out to LA to meet him. He was living in a furnished room all alone. We met in a bar.
Stop smoking these. Do you get into New York much, Cal?
Every so often, yeah. I actually had lunch with a friend of mine down in the village last week.
Ah, the village. That brings back memories. More than 40 years ago, the 2 summers I worked at my degree at NYU. I remember the true village. The cafeterias where we used to sit for hours on end, talking about our hopes and aspirations. And O'Neill, that sick, lean, hungry O'Neill, there's one actor is tucked under his arm, always seeking solace in the theater.
You became a teacher in Newark after that, didn't you?
The years have slipped away, and many things bother me, not just the teeth or the diabetes, but a host of things, past and present, which still plague me.
Dad, we all have things that torment us, but if you could just talk to somebody or to me...
You mustn't worry about me. When I've gotten over these hurdles, you'll know about it.
Well, you could just talk to
me. I would like certain areas of my life to become more tolerant. And this will take time. I'm struggling with my own personal adjustment. And I see you, the way you live so confidently. You have a wonderful family. Wealth is ephemeral, and what you have can't be bought.
Dad.
You see how I talk?
The world outside looms large and hostile.
I know I sound like a tired old man.
A few years back, I sent you a short story of mine. You wrote back with a beautiful critique I brought with me.
Son, the exercise of a particular craft is one of mission and is closely allied with God. One perfects a craft only through exercise and practice and more practice. I tell you, get it down on paper. Wear out the seat of your pants. Write. Write anything. Write everything. But write. I must warn you, there are no half measures in art. I love you, Harold.
Dad, reading your letter was like drinking an elixir of inspiration.
I've wasted so much of my life. Time is a runaway child, gay, unconcerned, frivolous. Hold on to it. Tame it. Make it work for you.
Dad, I was so young when Mom died. Could you tell me anything about what happened? Fill in any of the blanks? How did you two meet?
I was directing a play down at the old Jewish Y on High Street in Newark. She came to audition. And she was very beautiful, just 18 years old. I loved her very much. And she was very, very beautiful. But she was very young. She wasn't patient with me.
I saw my father once more after that, before he died.
Last Thursday, I saw you at the cemetery. You were standing next to your mother's grave. You had tears in your eyes.
I don't do it very often, but for whatever reason, something drew me there that day. I keep a picture of my mom at my desk. I'm usually a pretty happy guy, but every so often I'll stare at that picture. She's so beautiful, so young. I feel like a double loss, like I've lost both a mother and a child.
It's not fair!
Life's not fair, it's life.
Okay, whenever I hear about a soldier dying in battle or a child dying of neglect, I mourn for them. Right? I can't help but think of my mother. Not a day goes by.
I know. I feel bad.
Oh, sure. So you give me parking spots in Manhattan.
Listen to Mr. Perfect. There were plenty of times where you screwed up. Remember that time?
Okay.
How many jobs have you had these past many years?
Lots, maybe 20.
And how many did you actually apply for?
2 or 3.
And all the rest just happened?
Phone calls. out of the blue are bumping into people.
Remember that time in Puerto Rico where Henry Ginger called you up and offered you a job at the New York Times as their correspondent?
Yeah.
A few years later, you were up in Buffalo with your family, freezing your tuchus off, wanting to relocate.
Yeah.
And Jacobson, a complete stranger, called you up and offered you a job in the government in New York City.
Bob Jacobson, you arranged that.
And Leon King, when he randomly called you out of the blue and offered you a book contract. I whispered in quite a few ears, Cal. You've got a loving family, good friends.
God has a guilty conscience. You know, every so often when I go on my morning walks or lie awake in bed, I can't help but think, how should one live? Is there a right way?
I've given you free will. Moses was a good man, but he tended to ramble.
I don't even remember all 10.
You had a good teacher in your Grandma Ida. Better than Moses. She taught by example.
Everybody loved Grandma. She was the greatest person I've ever known.
Life would all be so simple if we just lived by one commandment. Just one.
Be kind to one another.
You said it.
My mom. I was so young, she died. Would it be possible, just for a moment?
I'm sorry.
Please.
Well, okay, just a quick look.
I first heard tango whenever I was in my late 20s, and I fell in love with it. My aunt told me that my mom once won a tango dancing contest in Newark.
She was very talented.
It must have been then when I was a young boy that I heard tango for the first time. It explains why I get a strange mix of joy and sadness mixed together whenever I hear it. I wonder, did my mom and dad ever dance the tango together? Could I see them together one last time?
You're asking a lot.
Be kind to one another.
All right.
Will anyone else here with them?
Just us. Better get going. Other calls to make.
I don't think you know how much this means to me, seeing them together of them, together again.
I'm glad.
It's like this big dark cloud that's been following me for all these years has suddenly drifted away.
Drifted away.
I'll never forget this.
Good. There was a nice writer once, good fellow,
Graham Greene.
I overheard him speak once. He said, To some extent, writers seek their own craft to heal a wound. Maybe if you wrote about your mother, it might help a little.
Are you giving me divine guidance? You're a really nice guy. Being who you are, seeing all that you see must get very lonely and sad. Can I give you a hug?
A hug?
You know how in Latin America, when two buddies get together or in leaving, they give each other an abrazo, a hug. Can you show me some of those dance moves you?
Yeah. Oh. I have something for you. Now it's all in the hips.
Yeah.